are moving through the Gospel of Mark because we're trying to answer this big question, that is, why Jesus? Why him? And it's really an intellectual honesty question. If you've been here, I've kind of probed and kind of pushed towards that because I want you guys to intellectually consider who Jesus is. And here's why. Because if we understand who Jesus is, even if you don't believe in him right now, but if you get information and learn about him, who he is, who he claims to be, my prayer is that it'll move from up here down to our heart. He'll change us and change who we are. And that's really what we're trying to get to know who Jesus is. Now, thankfully, we have a good resource because Mark tries to answer specifically that question. His first about seven to eight chapters is specifically geared towards who's Jesus? Why him? So if you have your Bibles, and I hope you do, Mark chapter 6. A lot of you have signed up for the YouVersion Bible app, which is awesome. I think some of you just even friended me this week on that. So if you have your Bible app, open that up as well. It's a great resource. And as I remind you each week, your assignment this week is to read Mark chapter 6 because I'm going to skim through it, but there's some really good stuff in this chapter that you'll want to read through on your own, and hopefully you're taking notes. I know a lot of you are. And also, if you have questions, please hit me up with the questions. I threw this offer out the first service. If you feel like, taking a preacher out for coffee, man, I'd love to do that for you and love to talk about Jesus over coffee. So that's a good deal. You can ask all your questions and I get coffee. It's a good deal. So I'm there for you. I'm here to help you out because I love talking about Jesus. And honestly, if you're reading this, you should have questions because I have questions. I'm trying to figure this out too. So don't be hesitant if you have more information that you want to get about who Jesus is. So Mark chapter 6 opens with Jesus going back to Nazareth, really for the last time. This is his last go to his hometown. And as he shows up in Nazareth and he teaches in the synagogue, people are like, wow, this is amazing teaching, Jesus. And yet we remember when you were in diapers. Now it doesn't say that in there, but that's what they're thinking because they have a hard time believing in Jesus because they remember when he was the little kid running around Nazareth. And they're like, we can't really believe you because we remember your parents and we remember you. And yeah, we just don't think you're better than us, okay? And this is one of the few times, I don't know the exact number, probably two or three times, when Jesus is shocked. He's literally surprised at their unbelief. Because there's so much information that's given to his hometown peoples, the Nazareth folks that know him and how he's fulfilled the Old Testament, because he literally quoted from Isaiah when he went there the first time, and he's done a few miracles, even though he couldn't do more because of their unbelief. He is shocked at their unbelief. Now, this is an important lesson for all of us as we live out the life of Jesus, as we talk about Jesus. There are going to be people that are not going to believe. Even though the facts are there, they can see it, it can make sense, they can rationally, they're not going to accept it. This needs to be something we always understand. People are not always going to accept who Jesus is. Jesus' hometown folks didn't even accept who he was. After he's done in Nazareth, he gets his 12 apostles together, and I'm kind of going by a chronological timeline here. This is probably about 1 year away from his crucifixion. So we're entering into his last really big year of ministry, and time is running short. And he's been preparing these apostles to carry on the mission when he's gone. So he empowers them to go two by two to the rest of Galilee and to preach about the good news, about how God is coming and he's coming to rescue his people and that they need to repent and turn to God. And then he gives them the power to do miracles. And so he sends out all 12 of them two by two and they go all over and they do that. I find this really interesting for one particular reason, because part of those duos would be who? Judas Iscariot. Now we always think of Judas at the very end. He's the one that betrays Jesus. He's the bad guy. But in this instant, he's sent out and he is a part of God's work, his good work of preaching. And he gets to see firsthand how people respond. Because once all the disciples come back, they're really jazzed. They're really excited because people are responding to the message. And it was very successful and they were able to see God at work. And Judas was a part of that. All of them were a part of that. And they come back and they're excited and they're talking to Jesus. I'm sure they're just talking a mile a minute as they're talking about all their adventures, all the things that they were able to see. While they are talking, word gets to Jesus that John the Baptist has been executed by Herod the Tetrarch. I'm not going to have time to go over all the details of what transpires to lead to that execution. But John is significant. He's a relative of Jesus, first of all. He's prepared the way for Jesus, and now he's dead. And I'm sure that had an effect on Jesus. But one of the things, well, actually, there's about three things I want you to take note of and why this is significant. First of all, Herod the Tetrarch is the son of Herod the Great. So when we read the Christmas story about Jesus being born in Bethlehem and all the babies that were killed in Bethlehem, that came from Herod the Great. That would be Herod the Tetrarch's dad. It can get confusing, I know. A few years ago, we spent 3 years. This is back when we did like Sunday school. We took 3 years and we went through the chronological life of Christ. And so we actually had to come up with a chart to show all the different Herods, because there's a lot of them. But this is one of his sons, Herod the Tetrarch. Now, why this is significant is because you can go in history, in history books, and read about the Herods. You can read about Herod the Tetrarch. So we know that Jesus and some of these words are very reliable. We can trust this stuff because, okay, it's in history. It's very trustworthy sources that back up what the Bible is telling us. But we also know that Jesus is beginning to have some political effects. There's a ripple effect to this ministry that's going on up in northern Galilee. Okay, the king's starting to take note of what's taking place. He wants to figure out, and this fits the entire series we're going through, he wants to know who is Jesus. He has some suspicions about who he thinks he is, but he wants to figure out who Jesus is as well. Here's the third thing, and you might find this to be the most fascinating, especially if you read through the chapter, you're going to discover that politics hasn't changed a whole lot over the years. It's just as controversial, scandalous, and it's a soap opera, okay? And that's essentially what the whole incidents surrounding John's execution, what takes place there. So you can read that as well. So because of all those events, tired group of apostles that have come back, they're exhausted. Jesus wants to get out of the political spotlight. He needs some R&R. He needs to get away with his disciples so that they can talk, debrief, and they can just rest. So he tells the guys, let's get in the boat. Let's go find a place where we can just hang out and relax. So they get into this boat, and they go a little ways around the lake, but people see where they go, and they begin to run as fast as they can. They tell all the people they run into, hey, Jesus is going over in this direction, and we're guessing, this is a hypothesis, but it's around Passover time. So we're 1 year away from his last Passover, but there's a lot of people that are coming in, and they're hearing about this Jesus. The crowds build, and so when Jesus comes to shore, there is this massive crowd of people on the seashore waiting for him. Now, if I was Jesus and I was tired with the tired disciples, I would look at the crowd and say, Pete, turn it around. We're heading further down, you know. But Jesus doesn't do that. Jesus doesn't do that at all. In fact, if you have your Bibles, this is where I want you to dive in. Look at verse 34. It says, when Jesus landed and saw the crowd, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. So Jesus, thankfully, is not like us, okay? He looks at these people and he has compassion on them because he looks at them and he understands what is motivating them, what is driving them. They're lost. They're lost. I wish I could be like Jesus in this, because sometimes when I look at people and I'm tired, and you know, I don't know if you realize this, but people always want more, okay? There's always more, and if you work in the people industry, you get this. You're never good enough. There's always more. People are takers. That's just who we are. We're consumers. And these people want more and more and more, and Jesus looks at them, and he realizes what they really need is someone to lead them, someone to teach into their life. He has compassion on them. I think a good teaching moment for all of us here is that when we see people and we feel exhausted, like we can't give anymore, or maybe someone is short with you, or they snip at you, or they're upset with you, I think one of the things that really helps me is to look behind the scenes and understand, you know, I wonder why this person's so upset with me. I wonder if they had a bad day. I wonder if they got news that they're sick or their mom has cancer. You know, what's driving this? And I think if we look at people, not just at face value, begin to know their story, it helps us have more compassion and be a whole lot more patient with people. And that's what Jesus understands is what's driving this crowd. So he has the disciples get out of the boat and he begins to teach. But here's the problem. The sun is starting to set low in the sky, and the disciples start looking at this massive crowd, which we learn is 5,000 men. So it doesn't include the women or the children. This is a huge mass of humanity. And as the sun goes down, the disciples look around like, Jesus, there's no food trucks around here. There's no place, restaurants or places these people can go. Where are they going to go to eat? And Jesus, I love his response, you feed them. The disciples start panic. You know, Judas Iscariot looks in the money bag. I don't think that's going to be happening. You know, there's a lot of nerves and fear. Like, we can't do this. In fact, one of the disciples says, that's a half a year's wages. We can't possibly come up with enough money to feed this great crowd. And so Jesus then asks them, well, how much food do you have? So they scrounge around and they find 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. Now, when we think of the bread, it's not like the big loaves you get at Hy-Vee, you know, the big loaves of bread. It's probably, you know, just little round cake things. They're not that big, probably like a barley loaf, kind of small. And then the fish aren't big catfish or walleye. You're talking maybe sardines. They were kind of like a relish that they would put on the bread, maybe kind of a fish taco type thing is what they were looking at. So you're talking about these little loaves of bread and two fish. That's all they have. And so Jesus takes it, and he thanks God for providing that little meal. I'm sure the disciples are like, what is he going to do with this? Now, here's one of the things I think is so fascinating. So we understand that Jesus has stopped so that he can do what? Teach. So he can teach. We don't get any word that he teaches in this setting. Not one. Like, there's no sermon that we hear about. Nothing. What do we get? We get a miracle. This instant multiplication as Jesus reaches into the bag of food and he just keeps pulling it out. Remember, we talked about this last week in regards to miracles. Miracles are teaching moments in and of themselves. When we see a miracle, it's not random. It's just not Jesus doing his random awesomeness. He is teaching something in the miracle. So here's where we need to stop and figure out, well, what can we learn from this miracle? Because Jesus is reaching into this bag and he's pulling out fish and bread. Let's just be honest, it's fish and chips. Okay, he's a seafood guy. Okay, and he's just pulling this out and he's handing it to disciples who've, you know, put groups of 50 and 100 all over, and they're just going and they're just taking food and people are eating. So what do we learn from this moment? What's the teaching moment that Jesus wants us to get? Well, I want you to pick up with, what's the next verse here? Verse 42, it says, they all ate and were satisfied. Highlight that phrase. They all ate and they were satisfied. And the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces of bread and fish. The number of men who had eaten were 5,000. So Jesus is passing out all this bread and this fish. People are eating and their tummies get full. Every single person there is satisfied. People that were starving and they were hungry and they were there, didn't know where they were going to get food, God provides. It's like that video we watched at the beginning about miracles. We're always looking for the big miracles. And what Jesus is teaching, one of the things he's teaching here is that God's going to provide. He's going to take care of us. There's going to be provision there. But the word that I want to hang out on this morning, the thing that he's teaching his disciples and he's teaching us, is that Jesus satisfies. So if we're talking, this series is about Jesus, why him? I would answer that question through what Mark is teaching us here, is that Jesus satisfies. Jesus satisfies. So what do we learn from that? Why is that such an important thing, this whole idea of that Jesus satisfies? Well, let me quote the great theologians, the Rolling Stones. I can't get no satisfaction. Okay, some of you aren't Stones fans. That's all right. That's all right. I can't get no satisfaction. There is a human dilemma that we struggle with, and that is we're never satisfied. You see, as soon as these people are done eating fish and chips on the beach, a few hours later, they're going to be what again? They're going to be hungry again. They're going to need some more food. All of us here have this issue with satisfaction. I saw some of you when I was talking about fish and chips. You leaned over and said, "Hey, honey, we're doing Red Lobster. Yeah, for lunch. Here we go. I'll go with you too. I'd love to talk more about Jesus over Red Lobster." Who wouldn't? Because we're always looking for the next what? The meal. Our whole lives are built around eating and food because we have these bodies that are completely dependent on always having energy, and we need water, we need food. There's this dependency. And what Jesus is teaching is that God is providing for us. That's why he gives thanks for those fish and loaves. And then God provided for everyone that was there. God wants to provide for us. But the thing is, it's more than just that. As humans, it's more than just food for us. We're always looking for something more. We're never satisfied with our job, are we? We always want more money. We want a better raise. We want more vacation time. We're looking for a better career. We want a new car because the one we have doesn't work. We need a new relationship because he's a jerk. And, you know, I could use a new spouse, right? We're always looking for more because we can never fully and completely be satisfied. It's this curse that just eats at us. And if we would go around the room even now, I'm sure we could find some dissatisfaction in some areas of our lives that we wish were better, wish were different. It's a curse, and we're caught up in it. And what Jesus wants to teach us is that he can satisfy. Now, why is this important, that we find this answer for our satisfaction? Well, Jesus actually, in the Sermon on the Mount, tells us why. He says in the Sermon on the Mount, he says that as if we seek after all these things, that all we're going to do is worry. So have you ever connected the dots here that a lot of our worry goes back to our dissatisfaction? Because we always need the new outfit and the new shoes, and we have to have some changes at our job and work. All the things that we're dissatisfied, it causes us to worry, and it pushes a lot of unneeded energy in all these different areas that, let's be honest, at the end of the day, they don't really fix, they don't really satisfy. And here's what's really, really dangerous. Let's get serious here about this just for a second. There's a lot of destructive behaviors that we end up in because we're trying to be satisfied. So you look at alcohol abuse, drug abuse, prescription drug abuse, you look at pornography, you look at codependency, you look at eating disorders, even being a workaholic. They all go back to that dissatisfaction we have in our lives, and we're trying to satisfy some desire deep inside of us. And we end up in this destructive loop. We end up harming our own selves trying to find satisfaction. We can't see it. That's the problem. Jesus goes on and says this in the Sermon on the Mount. He says that where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And for a lot of people, maybe even you this morning, that dissatisfaction that you found, you've put something there at the center. You've made it your treasure. A person, a relationship, a cause, a job, whatever is stirring in your heart. And you've given everything over to it. What Jesus is trying to teach in this moment is pretty powerful. He's saying, listen, I can satisfy. I can satisfy. So just for a moment here, I want to talk to two different groups of people. If you're here this morning and you've never fully given your life over to Jesus, you've believed in him and you've publicly declared that Jesus is your Savior, I want to talk to you just for a minute. And I want to ask you this question. What is your purpose here on this planet? Why are you even here? Is your purpose here on planet Earth to continually be looking for what's next? Is that why you're here? To find the relationship, to find the family, to have the kids, to get the house, to get the, you know, the picket fence and the two-car garage? Is that why you're here? Because you're never going to be satisfied, because the car is going to break, the house is going to need repairs, and the relationship is going to be a mess, and the kids are going to rebel. Okay? Sounds exciting, right? Sign me up. But yet we buy into this endless cycle of doing the next thing, and then there's never completion to it. Is that really what our purpose is? Is purpose pleasure? To feel as good as we can? To be as happy as we can? Is that our purpose? Because what Jesus is saying is, I will give you purpose. I will give you purpose for your marriage. I will give you purpose for your work. When we look to Jesus to satisfy us, our job makes sense. Our relationship makes sense. Kids make sense. We understand why we are here and what we're supposed to be doing. So if you've never put your faith in Jesus, here would be my invitation to kind of answer that question, is that Jesus satisfies. He gives us purpose. Gives us purpose. Now, if you're here and you're a Christian, what's the tug of war that we spend the rest of our lives going through? Keeping Jesus at the center to satisfy us. Because there's always a pull. Our world, its job is to always be pulling Jesus out of the center and putting something else in the center of our hearts. And that's the tug of war that goes back and forth. So for me, as pastor, I struggle with this as much as anyone does. I have to make sure that for me, I'm not trying to find satisfaction, for example, in my wife. Okay, my wife, Susie, she's amazing. But she can't be at the center of my life, because if she is, I quickly learn that she can't satisfy me. She can't, because she's going to fail me. She's going to let me down. She just can't complete me. Does that make sense? My kids, I can't put them at the center of my life, because they don't satisfy me. Because again, they're going to let me down. They're humans just like me. They're going to make mistakes. They're going to hurt me, and I'll become frustrated. As a pastor, I can't look as a successful church to be the center and the purpose of my life, because you all let me down, just like I let you down. And I'm going to be frustrated because maybe we're not growing, or things aren't happening, or just fill in the blank. You can become very dissatisfied with that when you put things that aren't God at the center of your life. But here's the thing, though. When I make Jesus the center, where he satisfies me, not only am I closer to him, but I'm closer to Susie, my wife, because I have a better relationship with her because Jesus is at the center. I have a better relationship with my kids because Jesus is at the center. He helps bring clarity and understanding. Same thing with my work, even church. Things go better. They make sense because I'm not looking for satisfaction from those. I'm finding my satisfaction, my life. I'm finding it in Jesus. Jesus satisfies. I'm going to take this one more step. And we're going to go to the Gospel of John, because Mark does not give us what happens next. So Jesus has fed the 5,000. Everyone is satisfied. He gets into his boat with his disciples, and they go back to Capernaum. And once again, people know that he's going there. And so the shore is lined with people. And this is where John picks up the next part of this story. John chapter 6, verse 32 is where we'll be here in just a minute. So as Jesus gets onto shore, there's all these people there, but they see Jesus differently now. You know why? He's fed them food. This happens when I grew up on a farm. And here's what we learned. Anyone who's dealt on grown up on a farm, you know about what I'm going to say. When a cat shows up on the farm that you have never seen before, you feed it. It will never go away. True, right? You feed a stray animal, they're yours forever. This is exactly what happens. Jesus has been a great teacher, and they've loved Jesus' teaching. And he's done miracles. They love his miracles. Now Jesus has fed them. Oh my goodness. All right, so the Jesus junkies are just loving this. You know, these are the ones that have all the Jesus t-shirts, Galilee Tour 1 and Galilee Tour 2, you know, and they've heard all the teachings. They can almost say Jesus sermons by heart. And now there's a Jesus buffet that goes with the event. This is awesome, okay? And so people see Jesus now as their meal ticket. He will feed them. So the crowd is there, and they can't wait to listen to Jesus, see him do something amazing, and then he'll feed them. So Jesus is frustrated. Jesus, in fact, if you have time today, read all of John chapter 6. You can sense the frustration. He's frustrated. So the talk then turns to how Moses provided manna for the Israel back in Exodus while they were wandering around, you know, after they left Egypt. And so this is what Jesus then follows up that discussion with. Look at verse 32. Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Sir, they said, always give us this bread. Then Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But as I told you, you have seen me, but and still you do not believe. Jesus wants them to believe in him. Jesus wants the crowd to accept him, but they want Jesus for what he will give them, and Jesus wants to be something for them. Do you understand the difference? The crowd is looking to Jesus for what he will give them, and Jesus wants to be something for them. Let me describe the difference. This may even be taking place in our room, even as we speak. I think a lot of us here love Jesus, but do we love Jesus for what he is and what he can be for us? Or do we just love Jesus because he'll forgive us and he'll get us into heaven? In other words, do we walk around thinking, I'm going to believe in Jesus because he's going to help me have a really good day? And I know that if I sin, he's going to forgive me. And boy, I know if I die, I'm going to go to heaven. So I like this Jesus. Is that why we pursue Jesus? For what he's going to give us? Or are we willing to make Jesus the center of our lives and he begins to transform us where we see the world differently and we see our own lives differently, where Jesus literally is at the center of our lives? And my fear is, for a lot of Christians, and maybe even you, Jesus is someone that you're around because he's like this good luck charm, this Jesus in my pocket. Wherever I go, I know he's going to get me through and he's going to give me something. And if that's the Jesus that you're pursuing, well, that's the same Jesus that the crowd wanted. Give me, give me, give me. We'll follow you anywhere, Jesus, because you're going to give me this. And that's not life. And that's not what Jesus wants to be in for you. He wants you to believe in him so that your soul is satisfied. So that no matter what happens this day, you can say, Jesus, I'm satisfied in you. Even when it feels like your world is turning upside down and things aren't making sense, you can say, I, Jesus, am finding satisfaction in you. Now, after Jesus is done teaching here in John chapter 6, because he's going to say some hard things like, you need to eat my flesh and drink my blood, and people are just going to freak out, and they're going to just start leaving. They're just going to walk away, and they're like, we can't do this. This is too bizarre. His disciples are even going to say, Jesus, this is too difficult. And maybe that's the tension you're feeling in your life right now. This Jesus that is being presented to you is going to be a radical change. It's going to be too hard. But Mark is being honest. John is being honest. They want you to know that those longings that you have in your heart can be satisfied, but you have to make Jesus the center of your life. Who is Jesus? Why him? Because Jesus satisfies. Heavenly Father, I pray over this group that you've pulled together this morning. You brought us here into this room for a reason. You want us to know Jesus and know him more. And I pray that every single one of us in this room, we have longings, we have desires, we have emptiness that needs to be filled. I pray that we would find our completeness, our satisfaction in Jesus. And for some of us, that means looking at Jesus in a new light. For others, it may simply be seeing the Jesus that's right now in front of us and having the courage to believe in him. But whatever the case may be, Father, I pray that we would not leave this place without finding our satisfaction in your Son, Jesus.